You, Brett Ratner! You're watching Beyond the Trailer's review of X-Men Days of Future Past.
It's good to take the two of us side by side at a time when we couldn't be further apart.
You took the things that mean the most to me.
Maybe you should have fought harder for them.
There is a new enemy out there. Mutants. You'll need a new weapon for this war.
I know what I have to do. It's us or them.
To date, X-Men The Last Stand is still the highest grossing film in the franchise, both stateside and worldwide. But is that vindication for Brett Ratner or a testament to what Bryan Singer built before he walked away to direct his dream project, Superman Returns? It's a hard question to answer definitively, but we do know for sure that Singer's dream turned into a nightmare. For everything he seemed to get right with X-Men, he seemed to get wrong with Superman. Luckily, Tom Cruise needed Singer for Valkyrie 2 years later, as the movie star, trying to polish up his tarnished image, found himself also shut out of the big leagues. Speaking of tarnished images, while Singer slowly but surely worked his way back into the X-Men franchise, he produced the underperforming but critically lauded and fan-appreciated X-Men First Class, he suddenly found himself stopped dead in his tracks due to some very serious accusations. In fact, they're so serious that 20th Century Fox and Singer have agreed at best he remove himself from the X-Men Days of Future Past's mega publicity tour while everything gets sorted out so as not to distract from the film. And luckily for everyone involved, there are plenty of other things to focus on. For instance, we're in the middle of a cinematic universe arms race. Marvel, DC, Sony, and now Fox are all looking to build their very own blockbuster factories. And Fox finds itself with a real window of opportunity here. As Marvel's Captain America: The Winter Soldier was forced to bow early, Sony's The Amazing Spider-Man 2 failed to impress, and DC decided to sit the summer out. There's also the Battle of the Quicksilvers. Thanks to dual team affiliations, both Fox and Marvel are creating their own silver screen versions of the Silver Speedster. Out of the gate, Joss Whedon and Aaron Taylor Johnson took the lead thanks to an unfortunate Carl's Jr. ad. But once audiences see Evan Peters as Bryan Singer meant him to be seen, well, let's just say there's already buzz that Peters has one of the best sequences in the movie. Then, of course, there's Jennifer Lawrence, hot off of The Hunger Games catching fire, making perhaps one of the franchise's most iconic roles her own. Plus, Singer and Fox's publicity department have done an excellent job getting audiences to start thinking about and eagerly anticipating X-Men Apocalypse, already greenlit to hit theaters in 2016, and the Wolverine sequel set for 2017. Ah yes, Hugh Jackman. He's at the center of this storm and always has been for 14 years. The franchise's one constant, along with producer Lauren Shuler Donner behind the camera. And while X-Men First Class did a lot to point this franchise back in the right direction, it was the Wolverine that got it back on track last summer. Hugh Jackman's second solo adventure is the second most successful film in the franchise after The Last Stand. So as Singer reunites with the actor he made a movie star, is the magic back?
Yes, the magic is back. Is this a perfect movie, though? No, but it has such high points, particularly the end of the film and that after-credits sequence, that I don't think it's worth nitpicking. I use the word nitpicking because that's something some of you say that I do with movies sometimes, and I really want to make the distinction that you nitpick a film when it doesn't work, when you have to roll up your sleeves and dig in and find out why. It's like performing an autopsy. But X-Men Days of Future Past is alive and kicking, and there's no reason to open it up. It works! And speaking of working, this film is clearly working very hard to correct all the problems created post-Singer in this franchise, which is a tall order. And the fact that I think it succeeds for the most part, and I think a lot of people will agree with me, really goes to the credit of Singer, Simon Kinberg, the producers, and also the cast, who stepped into these roles, some of them returning, some of them, you know, who've upheld it for a long time. That's really commendable for 14 years to maintain the quality, but we all know that's not true. I guess to bring it back, which is to some degree even harder. And bringing it back, that's a big part of why this movie works. There's two reasons it works, and the first reason is nostalgia. I felt like I was back in the theater watching X2, which had a very distinct impression on me. I know that other comic book movies came out before it, like Blade, Spider-Man was right afterwards, but X-Men to me, X2 came out after the first Spider-Man. I'm getting my dates mixed up. But when X2 came out, I think they had the right mix of special effects, storytelling, realistic aspects. It really was, I believe, one of the first great comic book movies that I've ever seen. And particularly because the X-Men are my guys. I love the X-Men. X-Men and Batman are my two favorite comic book properties. And to see them brought to life so well and so accurately was so exciting. And so, and I just remember X2 so well. I remember being in the theater. I remember going. I went with my parents. We went to an unreasonably late showing, like 10:30 or something. You know, you really wouldn't think a family would go at that time, but I think we got sold out of the earlier times. As you can hear, it made such an impression on me. And this movie brought me right back to that. And I think that's not only to the credit of Singer, but also to Hugh Jackman. I talk all the time about how I think Mel Gibson looks more like the Wolverine of the comics. But I have to say, when you see Hugh Jackman here, and he takes you right back to when you first met him as the character, you can't deny that he has made not only the character his own, but the franchise his own. And as I said, that's very commendable in and of itself. And this just took me right back. And it helps that Hugh Jackman doesn't look like he's aged at all. But he was really good in the film. And there were certain moments, like when he just first goes back in time, that I was like, wow, this is X2 all over again. And it made me think that if J.J. Abrams can capture the same nostalgia with Star Wars, that could be something really special as well. But it can't all be about nostalgia. There has to be something else. So what's the other half of the equation? I would say potential. There is clearly so much potential for this franchise now going forward because it's righted almost all the wrongs that it's exciting. And that's why I think that X-Men Apocalypse is such a big part of the conversation here, because people, I want to see what's next right away, and I think a lot of people are going to leave the theater being like, I wish I could watch X-Men Apocalypse right now. And I think that's because the potential is there, not only what they can do, but I think we're seeing the series move more towards its comic book roots than ever before. Several of the characters really pay homage to how they were originally intended, particularly Magneto and Mystique, two characters I've never seen so close to their comic book counterparts, which is exciting. But yet at the same time, there's a character like Quicksilver in here, very well realized, by the way, who is not totally like his comic book character, but you can see that Singer understands the core of the character and how to make him really cinematic. I think that's something that Singer really specializes in, how to visually portray these characters and to utilize them in sequences to the best of their abilities. And by abilities, I mean power sets. So you've got nostalgia and potential. Now, some of you might think, hey, well, why is everyone criticizing The Amazing Spider-Man 2 for setting the stage for the next film? You know, as I'm saying that X2 is, I mean, see, it's not X2, as I'm saying X-Men Days of Future Past is doing. And the difference is that this sets the stage for the characters that are here. Whereas I think the big problem with The Amazing Spider-Man 2 was that it set the stage for Sinister Six, characters that were either on the peripheral of that film or weren't even there yet. Instead, I think if The Amazing Spider-Man 2 had focused on setting up the next film for this group of friends that have gone horribly wrong, Peter, Harry, Gwen, and then I think maybe they should have introduced MJ here, that would have worked. And that's what you see here. You see the stage being set for this particular group of characters that you're with. So flaws. They're very minor. I'm not going to go into them here because they are so minor. They'll be in my spoiler review. However, there is one that I want to point out. And I have to say it because I think there's a huge female fan base for the X-Men. Every comic book convention I've ever been to, any panel on women in comics, they always ask, what comic book got you into the medium? And almost without fail, every woman lists X-Men. Because it has, I think, not only the most female superheroes, per the quota, I guess, per character of any comic book out there, but I think it has some of the best. Really well-developed, strong female characters. And they're not in this movie. Mystique is there. I'll talk more about why Mystique works in my spoiler review, but it would have been nice to see more of a mix. I don't want an all-girl team like that all-girl, all-female X-Men comic that came out, which I think is not as good as it could because, it's the reverse. It lacks male characters. You know, the X-Men are about diversity, and I'd like to see some gender diversity in the film, not only because it would make it more entertaining to me as a viewer, but because I think it's particularly for a series that has such a strong female fan base. I will say, though, that the guys in this movie are so good-looking that it took me, I'd say, about a third to half of the film to recognize there weren't enough female characters in the movie. And the reason I realized it is there's this one sequence where a number of male X-Men are in a car, and they were driving along and they had a shot of that. And I was just sitting there and I was like, everyone in that car is so good looking. And they were so good looking, they knocked me out of the movie for a moment. And that's when I realized, I was like, wait a minute, where are the women? Nice job, singer, nice try. You distracted me with all this eye candy. But luckily, I did remember. And so I hope that's something that they fix going forward. Although, from what we're hearing, bringing back Storm and Jean Grey, etc., that they are going to fix it, you know, younger versions. All right, so I hope you'll check out my spoiler review. There'll be a link at the end of this video description. I really think that you should go and see this movie. It's an excellent film. Keep an open mind. There are changes made. It's not totally in continuity with the comics, but I think it is creating finally its own, you know, steadfast continuity, which is important for it to move forward. And also, I think the greatest thing here, and what this movie reminds you of, is that the X-Men are such a wonderful comic book property and story in general because they are grounded in civil rights. And that's something that many groups have struggled for and even still struggle for today. And that, I think that's what makes the X-Men one of the most real, perhaps overall, the most realistic of the superhero properties and the most hopeful. And I really think that Singer captured that here. I loved it. You don't need to see it in 3D. Write your thoughts down below what you thought of the movie if you've seen it. And I hope you'll check out my spoiler review right now.